Well, it's great here to be doing another lunch and learn in the Fiduciary series. And we're very excited today to have a very experienced, very knowledgeable fiduciary who we've worked together on a very nicely complicated transaction. And I don't think anything in the world of fiduciaries is ever easy. It seems like a lot of the things that you guys have to deal with are complicated and need care and a lot of knowledge and experience. But David, thank you for joining us today. Please introduce us a little bit to you and your fiduciary setup.
Sure. My name is David Keeler. I'm a fiduciary in San Francisco. I've been practicing for 13 years now. Before that, I was in high tech, which is a little unusual in San Francisco, but almost standard down in Silicon Valley, Santa Clara.
Yeah.
I'm going to talk about the three primary things that I use when I evaluate using a realtor, things to look for. Yeah.
Our topic today is really, you know, what are the things, the most important things to look for when kind of hiring an agent, and ultimately that what are the things that to avoid, but what's the number one criteria that you have?
Yeah, well, I want to play off what you said. I mean, the very first thing I've got is that probate sales are often complex, sometimes very complex, and they can be very time consuming. They're unlike a normal real estate transaction. So before you get into one, or as you get into one, make sure you kind of think the steps through and realize that there are a few hoops you're going to have to jump through to get that done.
Yes.
Anyway, when it comes to the things I look for, the number one absolutely is experience. And when I say experience, I mean both the amount of time the realtor has spent as a realtor selling properties and the number of probate and trust sales that they have taken to closure. Again, they're not always the usual thing. And even with a trust sale, there can be one or two things, having to file a notice of proposed action and wait for responses, that kind of thing, that can lengthen the cycle. And if the trust is under court supervision, then there are even more things that might lengthen the cycle. So you really want to have somebody who's been through the drill and is familiar with the steps and the timing and the kind of things that can come up. Not just with the sales process itself, but sometimes on the back end, even with the court.
And in my being on the real estate end of it, I find that one of the key things, not only is it to save the estate money, because when the agent doesn't know what they're doing, every time you involve the estate attorney and yourself, like, this is stuff that is jamming up the system, and there is cost and time and effort that kind of wheels that are getting spun that can be problematic for the process. But really is the ability to be able to explain to somebody who's going to purchase a probate property what to expect, because when they don't fully understand what they're getting involved in, you can lose those buyers, and that really can cost a lot of time and money, and it really is a mistake to avoid.
It can be crucial. As Eddie said, he and I went through a fairly complicated one that had at least two major curveballs thrown in very near the end of the process. And his ability to explain the process and why it was taking so much time and what the steps were going to be really did help keep the buyer on the line and get us to closure.
That is so, the other thing we were going to talk about really is team and having access to a team.
Right. Right. I had a little more here.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Sorry. Don't let me stop. You're saying such wonderful things. Don't let me stop.
I was just going to do a quick overview of what the process is like. I normally ask people if they've done it before. But as we've kind of referred to, you can have both court supervised and non-court supervised sales, both with trusts and with probate estates. And they're very different. Even in the case where it's non-court supervised, there are some things that you have to get court approval for usually, or you have to get the heirs approval for ahead of time. And with probate estates, the court involvement is pretty significant.
Yeah, significant.
Yeah. If you're selling a property with independent authority that you got from the court, if it's a probate sale, then the process is relatively straightforward, more like a normal sale. But there are still one or two other hoops you and your attorney will have to go through. But these are the kinds of things you want to have in a realtor who can explain to the other side. When you go through the court, if it's court supervised, you've got to get approval for the listing agreement. You've got to make sure that the buyer knows it's going to be a conditional contract, not final until the judge says so. You're going to have to deal with getting hearing dates and sometimes extensions. So the escrow can take quite a bit of time. And you really ought to be familiar with the auction process that happens at the end and the overbidding process. And explaining those things to a potential buyer are crucial. And things that Eddie is absolutely familiar with.
Yeah.
So it's important to have a realtor that understands the process and can explain it. They also need to understand your duty to the beneficiaries, because it can be complex in a given situation. Things like how much cash is there in the estate? Is the buyer going to need financing? All their liens or other debts on the property? Has somebody checked to make sure that the construction was done with permits? Or if there are violations from either the health department or the building inspector's department? And of course, you've got to have clean title. All of those things can increase time, which means increased cost and stretch out the resources of the estate if you don't have somebody experienced who's looking at that stuff up front. The other thing I stress is that you have to market to the market. You have to understand the specifics of your particular piece of property, the neighborhood, the conditions, again, if permits, liens, complaints, et cetera. Particularly at this point in time, which is early 2023, you have to realize that the market is volatile and lots of ups and downs in terms of price. And so you want to have a realtor that has a realistic approach to listing. You don't want to be greedy. You don't want to overlist. You need somebody who's experienced enough to get in there, set a list price that will encourage bids and responses, because that's really where the sales process takes place. The last warning.
I think to reiterate on that too, is that I think there can be scenarios where an agent who's not super experienced with the probate process and the court process, who may kind of look good because they're talking like it's such a great, oh, the value is going to be this, it's going to be that.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't materialize. And you know, you're backpedaling and it becomes you're the lawyer's invoicing the estate, which probably has diminishing resources available.
Yeah.
and you may have set yourself into a difficult corner.
Yeah. You may have set the heir's expectations inappropriately. Mm-hmm. And then you've got to deal with unhappy heirs that are saying, you know, you told me it was going to be this amount. I've been there. So you really have to be careful with the listing process.
And then the preparation process too, one has to be, for you, really careful. Like, ultimately, we should only be working with licensed and bonded individuals. On what's happening. So that's an area that's important that doesn't slip. The other thing that I think is interesting is a lot of people don't realize that with the court process too, the first bite of the apple before, when you get that buyer to go to court, you're setting up the terms for everybody else. So mm-hmm. you want to make sure that you're setting up terms that other people can achieve. So you don't have it too lucky. We're getting into the weeds, I think, probably.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah.
I mean, terms are hugely important, and can be more important than price. I have turned down the highest bidder because the terms weren't as good for my client as the high price, because they had financing or they had other issues. One property I sold had a violation against it, and the non-top bidder, the buyer agreed to take care of that themselves. And that saved a lot of time and money for the estate. So those kinds of things are as important as price often.
Yeah. And then having access to that team of proper kind of licensed and bonded people to be able to make sure that you're, you know, in compliance with what you need to be to properly take care of the heirs.
Right. The team is the third thing I look at. Both the realtor's back office team, they've got to manage the paper flow, and there's a lot of paper, and they've got to stay on top of deadlines, and they typically coordinate with the title company. So having a good experienced back office is a real asset for a realtor and for you when you go out into the market. Having a title company that's experienced and that the realtor is familiar with can save time and money. And then again, the realtor should have a good team of vendors that they use: plumbers, contractors, haulers, painters, staging people. All of that is real important. So you want to think of it as a team effort, in addition to you and your attorney.
Yeah. And then there's the whole and final caveat that we won't get too deep into, but the joys in the San Francisco area of these type of properties when they are tenant occupied.
Then I have that down. Yeah.
Yes,
if you haven't dealt with a tenant situation, get ready for it. Because if you're operating in San Francisco, you're going to run into it. Make sure that the realtor has experience selling a house with a tenant in it, because sometimes you don't have a choice. You just have to do it. And if you're in a situation like that, depending on the realtor, get a good landlord-tenant attorney. There are several in San Francisco, and they're more than worth their fees. So make sure you get that. And hopefully you won't run into too many.
Yeah, proper counsel. And there are many good. Just all you have to do is it's an extra layer of complexity. But if you dot the I's and cross the T's, it's like doing anything else. It's fine. It's just you got to make sure that you're properly dot the I's and cross the T's.
And as a fiduciary, you've got liability.
Yeah.
So it's very important for you to cross those T's and dot those I's. It's important that you have an experienced landlord-tenant attorney if one is needed. And that you go through and do all of the back, all of the investigation into the background of the property so that you really know what you're dealing with. And it's also worth mentioning that while court supervised, you often have a choice as to whether you want to be court supervised for a sale. And not having the court involved certainly speeds things up and makes it simpler. But as a fiduciary, having that judge bring down his gavel on the sale really covers your butt for liability. And gives you a lot of protection for potential future lawsuits. So you want to think about doing court supervised, even if you don't strictly have to.
Yeah. And I would nearly say, when you get into the more complex ones, it would be just wiser and of an approach for just all involved to go that route.
If you've got difficult heirs or beneficiaries, if you've already got contention or even litigation going on in the case, protect yourself.
Are you dealing with like tenant scenarios that come in with different stuff? It's just you're better, the more people who are like, the courts are there to protect everybody, and so having the court involved is the best way to do that route. So,
always.
Yeah, 100%. Always. 100%. So, David, it is a pleasure, and you are always, you're so experienced and so knowledgeable about this, and you do such a wonderful job for your clients, and we really appreciate working with you, and thank you for joining us to just do this brief overview today on all of the good stuff. And if anybody is searching for your fiduciary services, how can they find you? They could look you up in the PFAC directory.
Going to the PFAC directory is the best way.
Best way. Find you right there. Perfect.
Yeah.
Awesome. So I greatly appreciate it, David. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Eddie. I appreciate it, and I'm happy to do it.